Outi.
Yes.
Outi Paloposki.
Fine, yes.
Paloposki.
Yes.
Okay, Outi, welcome to Tarragona.
Thank you.
Tell me, Outi, what's your job these days?
I work at the University of Turku in Finland.
Yes.
Sorry. And as professor of English, speciality in translating.
Okay. Are you in a translation department or an
English
department?
We don't have a translation department any longer. We have a School of Languages and Translation Studies. And there, the division is within... is sort of to group languages together, so I'm
okay.
In the English department.
Okay, is that a happy arrangement, or would you rather have something separate for translation?
There used to be a translation studies department, but as it goes, all the universities together are pressed for more cooperation, and in our case, in Turku, it has turned out really well. We have a wonderful...
It's good.
Yes, yes, it's excellent.
It's good to be general in the...
It is,
yeah,
it, yeah. Yes, at least in our case, yes, definitely.
Okay. And you do... Translation research.
Yes.
We know you, we read you as a researcher in certain areas. Is there a structure or a research center for that?
No. In Finland, there's a number of translation studies scholars and we collaborate.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a kind of a national association of translation researchers.
Yes.
And we try and work together. To because pooling our resources is key to, like, almost all of us nowadays are working in departments of languages, which is
okay.
Good in a sense in a way, but then again, when you do need to contact other translation researchers, we do not have a formal structure, so we are trying to sort of keep together by other means, by having created this national association.
That, I've been to conferences of Monaco.
Yes,
that's a Helsinki center.
Okay. That's a Helsinki Translation Studies Scholars.
Right.
Yeah, it's not called Monaco any longer. They have something called Trust at the
mm-hmm.
moment, actually. But that's where a lot of things are happening.
But it's the same idea that translation scholars
yeah.
in different departments
yes.
come together at,
exactly.
at a national
yes.
level.
Yes, yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
Which is, I find attractive as a model.
It is attractive.
Yes.
And sometimes I wonder... Thinking back, some 10 years back, I think it all started with a graduate school where we had, as translation scholars, we had a sub-program of our own.
Mm-hmm.
And the experience of working together was so fruitful and so good that we decided to go on doing it, even though we didn't have the formal structure.
Working together with whom?
Other researchers from other universities
okay.
in
yeah.
translation
yeah,
studies.
Sure.
Yes.
Okay.
We still have, like, every year we have a national seminar.
Mm-hmm.
on translation and interpreting in Finland and from in different universities. It's every university where translators are trained basically takes the responsibility for one seminar
mm-hmm.
every 5 years. So there's a round of seminars and we have a newsletter, we have an email list, and we have a Facebook group
Great.
For Finnish translation studies scholars.
Good.
So all those work pretty well.
Good.
Yeah.
Good. Let's go back to when you were 23, 24, 25.
Yes, a long
what
time
were you
ago.
Doing then?
I was in Bolivia, in South America, yes.
Of course.
Of course.
Where would have been the... But
yes,
you're from Finland,
in Bolivia.
Right?
I am from Finland.
Yeah.
I just happened, by happenstance, I happened to go to Bolivia. And I spent a year there translating, actually, from English into Spanish. Which is
what?
Kind of strange. I had my translator's training by then, and in Bolivia what happened was that I had friends who were working for the Methodist Church in Bolivia, and they had somebody doing the translation work for them between English and Spanish, and this person had left, and they didn't have anybody, and they were in trouble, and they had been without a translator for 2 months. So they asked me if I wanted to do the job, and I said,
mm-hmm.
well, I'm not a translator of Spanish. I was between English and Finnish. And they said, well... No problem, was aprender. Like, there's no problem, you learn.
Yeah.
And so I said, okay, if that's the, you know, the way you feel about it, it's okay. And I did learn.
So your languages are English, Spanish,
Finnish. And Swedish.
And Swedish.
Basically, yeah.
Are you from Turku then? From that area?
No, I'm from near Helsinki.
Okay.
But I studied in Turku. So
right,
I'm
so
back in Turku.
Swedish
We all learn Swedish at school.
Yeah?
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and it's important for a translation scholar in Finland doing history because Swedish was the language of education and administration and all that. So
okay.
all basically all the correspondence, all the minutes of the meetings, all the archives, all the archival material is in Swedish until the late 19th century.
Okay.
So it's very important to know Swedish.
Anyway, from Bolivia, you went back to Finland.
Yes.
And you started at the university, or were you translating professionally?
I translated for some time, and then I went back to university.
Mm-hmm.
And went around different universities in Finland. I actually have degrees from three different universities in Finland.
Mm-hmm. You're doing master's degrees then?
Yeah, I did master's in Turku and licentiate, which is something that doesn't really exist any longer, mm-hmm. in Tampere, and the PhD in Helsinki.
In Helsinki, okay. Yeah. In what then? In translation studies?
They were all in translation studies, but mm-hmm. then I've done linguistics at the UCL in London and some literary studies in at the University of Havana in Cuba. So
overqualified.
I'm overqualified, right. Yes. Definitely.
When did you start publishing in translation studies?
Quite late. When I was doing my PhD, my dissertation was an article dissertation, so I had four published articles.
Mm. On what topic?
On domestication and fragmentation, that's one of them. There was one on variety, on variation in different kinds of different linguistic varieties in translating and different varieties of translation. And then there was one on norms.
Okay, so very theoretical.
It was based on the idea that I was taking up claims or statements that other people had been making and testing them on my data, okay. on my Finnish data.
Translation between English and Finnish? Or
basically any language and Finnish.
Okay.
But in the 19th century, which is my main area, the translations were done, even if they had originally been, even if the work had originally been written in some other language, they were mostly translated via Swedish.
Right. Indirect translation.
Yes.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. So we know your name a lot for work on indirect translation and then on agency and
re-translations would be maybe the
okay
one that I have concentrated right. on recently.
Okay.
Why re-translate? Yeah.
Your work is more generally in translation history, or is that not correct?
Yes, almost all of it is situated in translation history, mm. but I see the relevance for whatever has been or whatever is happening today in the life of the translators, because, for example, the discussions that we have today about the profession,
mm-hmm.
if you go back in time and look at the historical situation, you might find some interesting comparisons there, mm-hmm. like what it is now. Like crowdsourcing, for example, that used to be done a lot 100 years ago in Finland.
Really?
Crowdsourcing. Yeah, I mean, it's yeah. not... It's not a new thing. It's mm-hmm. it's something that's happened before. Like a lot of people are, in different ways, of course. I mean, but it doesn't...
Do you mean that a translation job would be given out to non-professionals to do?
There were no professionals as such in Finland mm-hmm. in the late 19th century. And people might be collaborating. They mm-hmm. might be working together. They might be asked to work together, that sort of a thing.
Okay.
So...
So that was crowdsourcing before.
In a way, yeah. Of
the
course,
name
it's
came,
it's,
yeah,
it's so. Ahistorical to call it by the same name.
Yeah.
But still, if you see my point, it's, mm-hmm. you can look at similar kinds of phenomena at different points in time.
Okay. Yeah. And what about retranslation? Is that a specific topic of importance to
yes,
Finnish translation history, or do you think it goes according to historical periods?
Also, Finnish translation history, but I guess it's something that's just cropped up. Recently, for the last 10 years or so, there's been a lot of writings about retranslations. And
retranslation, we mean a work that has been translated once
yes.
into Finnish, and then it's translated again. Into Finnish, right?
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
And there's the possibility that the second translator leaned on the first translator.
Maybe that's one of the possibilities. Yes. And the other one is that, of course, they would want to be as far removed
mm-hmm.
as possible. And
so you've worked on the retranslation hypothesis.
Sort of, again, that seems to be one of the things that I have taken up. It's actually my colleague Kaisa Koskinen from
mm-hmm.
the University of Eastern Finland and I, who have been working on this together for more than 10 years now. It's been our sort of baby for a long
mm-hmm.
time, but now it's finally seems like it's coming out as a book in Finnish.
All right.
In Finland. So
for us who can't read Finnish,
I know.
What
have
you
written,
found?
We have written articles.
Yes. What have you found?
Well, I think we set out to see whether there are any... any similarities in all these different retranslation cases in Finland or between Finland and other countries? And I think recently there's been studies in other places as well, like in Slovenia or Turkey, which show that or Poland, that the situations vary quite a lot. And the political situation can be quite different and can cause different kinds of retranslations, or is a different reason for retranslating than the ones that we have had in Finland. And the different reasons in Finland why there would be retranslations are not just the ones that usually are always called upon when retranslation is being spoken about, like, you know, that the language is old-fashioned mm-hmm. and you have to do it again, and each new generation requires its own translation or whatever. But there's a number of other reasons. One is marketing. It's more easily marketable if you have a new product, mm-hmm. a new translation. Then there's ones that have been indirectly translated before. Some of those are being retranslated again directly, this time from the original language. And in Finland, specifically, the standardization process of the language in the 19th century was so fast that anything that was translated in the early part of the century might turn out later to be, well, that's where you can actually say that it's old-fashioned, but it's not because language changes, but because there were so many different variants of the language, and no one could tell which would be the one to win, so right. to say, or be standardized.
So there's no simple hypothesis such as increasing accuracy or anything like that?
No, nothing of the sort. No,
okay, so that was the original hypothesis, I think.
Yeah.
Good. What kind of research do we need, then?
In translation studies. I think we still need a lot of basic studies. Of course, I'm biased because I work in history, so I think historical studies are, you know, I think they give us more perspective to the situations that we experience daily, even today. But all other kinds of studies, like today there's a lot of, as I said, a lot of studies being done on the profession, and I think that's very useful and interesting, and also connects us
with more sociological studies.
Yes, that's what I was thinking about. Mm. And in that sense, we need a lot of interdisciplinary work, and we need to know the theories and methods of other disciplines in order to be able to relate to them, not just import things for our own sake, but to be able to relate to other disciplines and what's being done over there. So that's one thing. But in the history of translation, I think we still need a lot of studies on the basic empirical level. I've been recently looking at translation criticisms, and even if I thought that I knew a lot about what's happening in translation criticism in Finland or abroad, because I've also been following what other people have been doing, I still think that we have decades of translation history in reviewing that we know nothing about.
Like reviews of literary translation?
Yes, exactly. Okay. Because what usually is thought about is that the translators are invisible and they are not commented upon and so on and so forth. But I was looking for something else. I was sitting at the archives of one of the Finnish big publishing houses, and I came upon all these reviews where translations, even reprints of old translations, were commented on. So it was customary to write about translations.
And the translators are named.
Yes. And they were commented upon.
Yeah.
Old translators were reminisced with fondness, like this, and that translator used to do or used to be like that, and so on. So we still don't know a lot, but it's very labor intensive. You have to sit in the archives and you have to sort of.
What about that? Some people say that translation isn't a field in Bourdieu's sense, that translators are not competing against each other in the field of translation.
Mm.
The translation belongs to the field of literature or the field of economics, whatever the text is in. Do you think that holds? I'm interested in the case of minor literatures or into Finnish. I just noticed that in Prague, all the translators know each other and they do compete against each other.
Well, I guess that's something that's not really, may not often be spoken about. I guess translators always want to excel. They want to be better, not just compared with their own past translations, but I suppose you would. I mean, everybody does their best, I trust. And
but it does create a situation. Are translators known? Would a book sell because of the translator?
Sometimes. We have a few translators in Finland who are really visible and whose names sell. And not just sell, but it's people are interested in them and follow their advice in choosing books and that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. Or linguistic developments. One has a blog at the site of the Institute for the Languages of Finland that's followed a lot. And she comments on her translations and on the linguistic, whatever guidelines or standardization procedures are happening in Finland. She comments on those, and they have visibility to some extent.
Okay. Mm. So the general suppositions we sometimes read.
I sometimes think there are no such things as general suppositions. Or there are, but they don't apply to reality.
Okay. Mm. Which is one reason for doing research.
Yes.
Okay. Luigi, thank you very much.
Thank you.